So we're solving the diffusion equation. We've talked about first an explicit method for solving the diffusion equation, the forward time centered space scheme. That one turns out to be conditionally stable, that if you take a too large a time step, the solution will blow up. Then we talked about an implicit method, a fully implicit method, that was unconditionally stable, always stable, no matter what time step. But then every time evolution step, you have to solve a matrix equation. It turns out that an average of those two methods is the most popular method for solving the one-dimensional diffusion equation. That's called the Crank-Nicolson method. It has the advantage of being unconditionally stable. It has the disadvantage of having to solve a matrix equation at each time step. But on the other hand, the matrix turns out to be tri-diagonal, and it's a very fast algorithm. So let's set it up on our grid. So again, we're going to do the time stepping by doing a what is essentially an Euler method, a finite difference method in time across these two points. But what we're going to do now is average both the explicit and the implicit methods. So we're going to take the second order derivative in time at the L time, the second derivative in space at the L time, and also at the L plus 1 time, and average them. What that ends up doing then, because we're averaging the spatial derivative at between the L and the L plus 1 time, this difference method, this difference in the time, then becomes second order at the average time, at the time halfway between the L and the L plus 1 time step. So you can view this method as essentially calculating U at the midpoint between the L and the L plus 1 time step. So both the time stepping and the space stepping becomes second order. That's why this method is liked. OK. So how do we average those two? Well, then we'll end up with the difference equation, U sub j of L plus 1 time step, equals U sub j at the L time step plus delta t d over delta x squared. And then we're averaging the second order derivative at these two places. So we can divide by 2 here to do the average. And then we'll have the first, the second derivative at the L time step. So U j plus 1 L minus 2 U j L plus U j minus 1 L plus the second derivative at the L plus 1 time step. So U j plus 1 L plus 1 minus 2 U sub j L plus 1 plus U sub j minus 1 L plus 1, okay? And that's the Crank-Nicolson method. this is still an implicit method because the U at the L plus 1 time step is still on the right-hand side of this equation. We can see what the matrix of this method is if we do the following, right? We can simplify, we can let alpha equal this delta t times d over delta x squared. And then to get rid of this 2, we can multiply both sides of this equation by the factor of 2. When we do that, so what we want to do then is we want to take all of the L plus 1 times on the left-hand side of the equation, all of the L times on the right-hand side of this equation. So we have a U sub j L plus 1 here, and that will combine with the minus 2 U sub j L plus 1. with a factor of alpha. And we multiply by 2 here, and the 2 clears here. So it's a bit of algebra, a bit of algebra. So what do you end up getting? Let me write down the equation. So the left-hand side becomes minus alpha times u sub j plus 1, l plus 1, plus 2 times 1 plus alpha times u sub j, l plus 1, minus alpha times u sub j minus 1, l plus 1. That's the left-hand side. And then the right-hand side, where the u superscript l goes on the right-hand side, becomes alpha times u sub j minus 1, u sub j plus 1, l, plus 2 times 1 minus alpha times u sub j superscript l, plus alpha times u sub j minus 1 superscript l. Okay? And that's written in a form that suggests a matrix equation. Okay? So you're going to have a matrix A times a column vector. The column vector will be u at the l plus 1 time step on the left-hand side of the equation. And the right-hand side of the equation will be a column vector, which will have u at the l time step. I think to see that most clearly is to write a matrix. So we'll do it for the case of just 4 grid points. Okay. So let me show you the grid points. So let's say we have the 2 endpoints and then 2 more points in the middle. So this will be our J. So we'll have a 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay? So 2 interior points, 2 boundary points. And let's say that the boundary condition is given so that the value of U on the boundary is equal to 0. Okay, so we'll have a matrix. So the matrix will be 4 by 4. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So let me put the matrix in here. We're solving for a vector. The vector we're solving for is the u at the l plus 1 time step. So we have u sub 1 at l plus 1. U sub 2 at L plus 1, U sub 3 at L plus 1, and U sub 4 at L plus 1. And then we'll have a right-hand side, okay, which may be long, and I may run out of space. So let's see if I can fit that in there. Okay, so what is the first row of this matrix? The first row is the boundary condition, so that u sub 1, let's put the boundary condition so that u is 0 on the boundary. So the first row here will be 1. So u sub 1 L1 equals 0. So the other elements here then are all zeros. On the other hand, u sub 4 is also equal to 0. So the last row of this matrix will be 0, 0, 0, 1, so that picks out u sub 4, and u sub 4 is also equal to 0. Okay, so the last row here, a little bit off, the last row here is going to be 0. Okay, and then this equation then determines the two midpoints here. So we'll have, for j equal to 2, we'll have a minus alpha times u sub 1. So we have a minus alpha here. We have a 2 times 1 plus alpha for u sub 2. So this becomes 2 times 1 plus alpha. And then a minus alpha here. And this will be a 0. Then for j equals 3, this whole row then will get shifted to the right. So we'll have a 0 minus alpha, a 2 times 1 plus alpha, and a minus alpha. Okay? So you see that this left-hand side gets constructed into a matrix. Apart from the first row and the last row, which is set up for the boundary conditions, you get a 2 times 1 plus alpha going down the diagonal of the matrix. And then this term will be minus alpha going down the diagonal that's one below the main diagonal. And this term here will be minus alpha going down the diagonal that's one above the main diagonal. What about the right-hand side? The boundary condition had 0 and 0 in the first row and the last row. And then we have this mess here, so that goes in the second row. And I'm sorry, but j is equal to 2. So that would be, if we start from here, alpha U1L, which actually is 0, but we'll use that anyway. And then this one, j equals 2, so plus 2, 1 minus alpha U2L. And then squeezing into this second row will be this one, which will be alpha U3L. And that's the second row on the right-hand side. The third row, then, on the right-hand side will correspond to j equal to 3. So it will be alpha U2L plus 2, 1 minus alpha U3L. And squeeze in one more term, which is plus alpha U4L. And U4 is 0, but I'll put it there anyway. Okay? I hope this makes clear that this equation here then is a matrix equation. It's a very nice matrix because it's tri-diagonal. It has two diagonals, the main diagonal, one above and one below. And the matrix doesn't depend on time. So in your code, you only need to define the matrix once. Then if you want to be clever, you can do the LU decomposition of this matrix and then use the LU decomposition when you do Gaussian elimination at each time step. The right-hand side keeps changing in time. So every time step, you need to keep updating the right-hand side. The right-hand side depends on the solution at the previous time step. Boundary conditions can be put directly in the matrix. So let me summarize. In this video, I tried to introduce the Crank-Nicolson method for solving the one-dimensional diffusion equation. It's actually just an average of both the explicit and the implicit method. That ends up with a unconditionally stable method with a tri-diagonal matrix, which makes it very fast to solve computationally. In the next video, then we'll look at a MATLAB implementation of this scheme. I'm Jeff Chasnov. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in that next video.